Welcome back to the Collegiate Hearthstone National Championship, where over the next 7 weeks, more than 800 teams throughout the United States and Canada will be competing for their share in over $160,000 in scholarship prizing. My name is Cora Georgiou, and I'm joined on the desk today by the one and only Brian Kibler. Brian, we had a great time yesterday. Are you excited for today?
Yeah, definitely. It's a cool opportunity to see these players who are not only competing for prizes, but getting a chance to represent their schools as well. And I'm interested to see if there's any strange strategies that show up today.
Yeah, we had a little bit of interesting stuff yesterday, some pretty cool deck choices. Hopefully we see a little bit more today as well. Let's go ahead and take a look at exactly how this tournament's format will be working. The regular season, of course, teams are split into one of four regional Swiss groups, and they will play one match a week throughout the 7 weeks, which will then lead up to the regional playoffs. Teams with five or more wins will advance to a Swiss playoff bracket that will then feed into the top 16 teams from the playoffs, advancing to a championship bracket, and eventually the top two teams from each region will advance to the live national championship.
And these players will be competing these matches in the Conquest format. Each team submits four decks from unique classes. A little bit of a twist here, the teams will ban one of their own classes once they see their opponent's classes. So they get to choose what they think their best decks will be rather than eliminating what they think their opponent's best deck will be. Then the teams play best of five, choosing their deck for each game. The goal is to win one game with each of your decks. Once you win with a single class, you cannot play that class again.
Yeah, so we've been used to the Conquest format. The self-ban is sort of adding a little bit something extra that maybe isn't seen so much in competitive Hearthstone, along with the fact that each of the teams are going to be three people playing, you know, one game together. So the collaborative format also brings a little bit of a new element. So let's go ahead and take a look at which teams we'll be playing today. Up first, we are going to be heading to the East region. It will be Maryland taking on TCNJ, followed by UMass versus Sherbrooke. And then the North region will be Carleton versus Nipissing to close out the day. Of course, we had three fantastic matches yesterday. UT Dallas beating UT Dallas 3-0. NAU coming out on top of Washington 3-1. And CSU Fresno over Utah 3-2. So those will be our matches for today. If you want to get involved, make sure you let us know what you're thinking about the matches, who you're supporting, and of course, just feel free to ask us any questions. Tweet at Team Tespa or on Facebook /Team Tespa. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our first match of the day. It is, of course, going to be the University of Maryland taking on the College of New Jersey. Brian, what do you make of these lineups?
Well, first of all, I think I'd want to be on the Oasis Snapjaw side.
Right? Really?
Yeah, you know, you can survive one hit from the Savannah High Main. Yeah, he's a big threat, but he doesn't come down quite as early. Slow and steady wins the race.
Yeah. All right, fair enough.
But anyway, these are kind of similar lineups to what we've seen before. The Warrior, Shaman, Warlock seems to be a pretty core element of these teams. The difference here is the Rogue versus the Mage. I haven't really been impressed by Rogue in the matches we've seen so far, and Mage has tended to do very well. Without a ban, the Rogue runs into a lot of aggressive decks, and I think that we're going to see a lot of Pirate, Warrior, Aggro Shaman in this metagame.
Yeah, the Reno Mage has been very strong recently, and if the Rogue comes up against those aggro decks, it could be a problem. But at the same time, if it gets matched against the Reno Warlock or the Reno Mage, it's got a pretty fair shot at winning those matches. So let's go ahead and take a closer look at our first team. It's the University of Maryland. Andrew, Fang, Jammin, and KillerZ234 with accounting and finance, computer science, and biology. It's a nice eclectic group of majors.
Yeah, we've seen a really wide range of studies, you know, not necessarily, probably a little bit of a lean towards, say, math and engineering, but there you see the team on the screen there. They seem pretty happy, pretty excited to get to battle.
Yeah, I'm liking the school spirit.
Those look like fraternity hoodies to me, so.
The one on the left is clearly nicer, but, you know, at least they're matching somewhat. We'll give it to them.
But yeah, it looks like they are ready to go. So let's look at the next team, their opponents, the College of New Jersey. We have SoFlo studying criminology, KG DeCamish studying computer science, and Marissa, who's studying criminology.
Yeah, so this team actually was in the tournament last year, as well as, I believe, the year before as well. They had a different third partner, but they've since added Marissa, who is looking fabulous, but she just wanted to double check, I'm sure. And we've got some nice tie-dye action going on here. Yeah, maybe not. You know what? They're just getting ready.
They've got some you know, some lighting set up though. Looks like the string lights. Yeah. I think I had like actually a lot of string lights in my my college dorm rooms. They're kind of a
Christmas
thing.
Lights
kind of
year round. Thing, it was the cool thing to do at your windows. Everybody
that
liked to see
futon.
Those for some reason. Oh yeah. Well, I didn't have room for a futon, but you know, fortunately, did not need one. So here we can go ahead and look at the self bans. Maryland has banned away their warrior, and TCNJ has banned out their warlock.
This is a pretty heads up decision, I think, from TCNJ. They saw there's a rogue on the other side, and with the aggressive decks of the shaman and warrior, as well as the arena mage, their only deck that's weak to rogue is the warlock.
The arena warlock.
So this is, you know, so kind of a getting into the various intricacies of the self ban. You need to identify, well, what can we target with the decks that we, you know, have over here? It's like, oh, well, they have a rogue, so let's get rid of our warlock, and we're probably in good shape there.
Yeah, it brings a very new dynamic into the matchup as a whole. Usually you're banning away one of your opponent's decks. A lot of the time you'll see less and less shaman because that seems to be a popular ban, but now with a self ban, you're probably going to be seeing more and more shamans. So it was actually underperforming yesterday. We'll see how it works for TCNJ today.
All right. Well, we are getting into game number one. It will be TCNJ on that shaman deck, which we have see the lava burst in hand. This is aggro shaman.
Oh, yeah.
So New Jersey is looking like they're probably in a decent spot in this first game, getting a matchup they want to get against the warlock. Though the doomsayer in Maryland's opening hand is one of the key cards early in the game, can really slow down the ability of the shaman to get minions on board and get that repeat damage in.
Yeah, even the Earthen Ring Farseer would have been a fine keep in the early hand. Gives you something to play after Doomsayer on turn two, but they decide to throw it away. They're really looking for Reno Jackson, of course. Kazakus is fantastic as well. If you can get it right out on four, get a five drop for clear, it can be really helpful in this matchup. The Blast Crystal Potion also really useful against the Flame Reach Faceless, which can give Reno decks quite a bit of trouble.
Yeah, and New Jersey now has a pretty powerful looking hand. The problem, of course, being that Doomsayer on the other side. They, right now, have no ability to clear off Doomsayer on the next turn. They need to pick up something like a Lightning Bolt, perhaps a Weapon, or a Flame Tongue Totem to give them the ability to punch through Doomsayer if it does come down turn two.
Yeah, you kind of have to imagine that Maryland will, well, coining out the Doomsayer is always an option. It's more likely that it will clear your opponent's board at that point. If they were to wait until the next turn, TCNJ would be able to play down the Totem Golem, and then it would be a lot easier for them to clear off the Doomsayer, but they are going to decide to hold it.
Yeah, it's an interesting call to have to make, because coining out the Doomsayer leaves them with a hand of a bunch of expensive things that they won't be able to play for several turns. If they do wipe off their opponent's 2-drop, and then on turn 2 they life tap, their opponent just plays a bunch of stuff to the board, they're still in a pretty rough spot. And now this is interesting, because New Jersey drops the Totem Golem. They had the option to play Tunnel Trug plus Buccaneer, and if they did that, they would have access to their full complement of mana next turn. But now Maryland can play their Doomsayer, and New Jersey, at least currently, does not have an answer.
Yeah, New Jersey's going to need to find a Lightning Bolt, a Jade Claws, at least 2 damage to be able to clear off the Doomsayer. And like you said, they're overloaded for 1, so the Lava Burst is inactive in hand. They could have patches with the Small-Time Buccaneer, so a Spirit Claws draw would, with the Small-Time Buccaneer and the patches, be able to clear off the Doomsayer. So there's a lot of ways for them to be able to keep their board. Unfortunately, the Azure Drake is not one of them.
Yeah, and this is you know, kind of a punish for taking the specific line that they did. If they had chosen on turn 2 to play their Tunnel Trug plus Buccaneer, they would have had Lava Burst available here and could have potentially had a pair of buffed Tunnel Trugs that could, you know, get the bonus from the Lava Burst and kill the Doomsayer.
Yeah.
So in many cases, what you want to be thinking about in these turns, especially, you know, even some of the early turns, is what can my opponent do that is bad for me? Mm-hmm. And what can I do to set up for that thing? And Doomsayer is the worst thing that can happen to New Jersey this turn. And the choice of Totem Golem, despite being a very powerful card in the previous turn, left them unable to deal with that.
Yeah, and granted, I mean, It's very tempting. You see Tunnel Trog, you see Totem Golem on curve. It's fantastic.
Yeah, look what I got.
And it's only a 1 in 30 that your opponent actually has the Doomsayer because,
they've more than one card.
But one Doomsayer in the 30 card deck.
Well, there is also, there's things like if you're paying attention to your opponent's mulligan,
they kept
a card. And there are not that many cards that you want to keep in the matchup as they're just getting rubbed in here as
salt
they draw patches the next turn. So, yeah, this is actually a really unfortunate spot for New Jersey. They are going to play out a bunch of minions. Yeah, they see Maryland.
Hand.
This is actually something we just saw a lot yesterday of patches getting drawn and one or both of the teams either laughing or sighing.
Emoting, that was a mistake. Yeah, we actually saw quite a bit of patches in hand yesterday, and he may be one of the best legendary minions in the game right now, but when he comes into your hand, it's not quite as good. And Maryland picks up Kazakus on turn 4, which, as I said before, if you can play it on 4 into a pretty safe board state, you're not going to die on the following turn, then a 5-mana Kazakus potion can do quite a bit of work.
Against aggressive decks, I often like to just Kazakus for 1 in a lot of spots, because if you are able to get a board clear with a damage spell and maybe a little bit of extra armor, you often don't have problems having enough power in the matchup. Mm-hmm. You have problems having enough time. And mana efficiency is just so crucial. But for Maryland here, I don't think that the Kazakus is necessarily a bad call at all.
The Hellfire would have been pretty good, too.
But one of the problems here for Maryland is, depending on what they get, they need to get like AoE armor or AoE minion for this to really be worth taking the damage rather than just casting Hellfire this turn.
Yeah.
And New Jersey picks up a Flame Wreath Faceless, which is obviously in itself a big threat, and buffs up the Tunnel Trog to make it a more significant threat as well.
Yeah, unfortunately for them, Maryland has several ways to deal with it, actually. They have both the Siphon Soul with the coin, meaning they can access it on the following turn, or the Blast Crystal Potion. And I don't believe they picked up the AoE from the Kazakus Potion. It looked like...
No, I believe their Kazakus Potion was Armor Polymorph, if I recall correctly, from the modes chosen. And now Polymorph is obviously just very weak on this board because there's 3 different minions. And they do have the ability to potentially just coin out the Siphon Soul, which I have to imagine we'll see. Got to get rid of that 7/7. 7 is a very big number.
Yeah, I mean, the Blast Crystal Potion was an option. It sets them back on the following turns, though. Definitely better to play that later in the game when you have more mana available to you.
Yeah, coining on that turn is basically like, if you Blast Crystal Potion that turn, you're giving up your 1 mana every turn from now on.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Whereas if you coin,
it's just 1 mana this turn.
Mana,
and then you can Emperor on the following turn and discount everything.
You could Emperor on this turn, but this is pretty scary. Your opponent just got Steady Shot off of the Discover from Sir Finley. And if you do Emperor, you're facing 3 on board, but one of those 3 is a multi-buccaneer. Mm-hmm. So that can add up to a lot of damage very, very fast.
Yeah, and you haven't seen a weapon from your opponent yet. You kind of have to assume if they had Spirit Claws, they would have played it by now, because they did have 1 excess mana on the following or on the previous turn. Maybe you can rule that out, but they still might have Jade Claws in hand, or obviously the draw for the next turn. So still deciding not to go with that Hellfire.
Oh, and there is Jade Claws. How much damage is this? They have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, potentially 8, 9, 14 is what they're capable of right now. So they're actually very narrowly off lethal. And this is an interesting spot for New Jersey, because they can try and just clear off the Emperor. Mm-hmm. But if they try and clear off the Emperor, how are they going to win? A lot of people will end up being in a situation where they see Emperor Tharisson and they get so terrified at the prospect of their opponent getting multiple activations of it.
That they throw away their chance.
They spend a bunch of damage killing it. It's like, okay, well, how do you win this game if you spend 5 damage killing Emperor Tharisson? Mm-hmm. And as it stands, if they just throw all the damage to face, and that's actually exactly what they're doing, I like this line of play from New Jersey. They recognize that Emperor Tharisson is kind of a distraction right now, that Maryland just invested their entire turn on this discount, but now they're down to 3. We know that Maryland does not have Reno Jackson yet, and they still don't.
All right, so the Mind Control tech is active. They have the Kazakus Potion, which can give them 7 armor. It's a lot of options here this turn. They have access to Taunt.
Yeah,
Mistress of Mixtures isn't bad.
Mistress of Mixtures is a potentially valuable draw. They could. They could
Mistress
amusingly,
of Mixtures and Hellfire.
Or Shadow Flame the Mistress of Mixtures.
Yeah, that too.
Is that Polymorph plus 7? I think it is, yeah.
Yes, it is.
There's a little bit of a missed sequence, I think, from Maryland. They chose to attack into the biggest thing and then play their Polymorph potion. They could have chosen to play the Polymorph either first to give themselves the best chance of hitting Buccaneer, or attacked, then given the Polymorph the best chance of hitting the Buccaneer.
Attack one of the smaller minions.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
So, but now Maryland, they are up to 10 health. And New Jersey does not really have a way to punch through this taunt. Though, again, Maryland is light on actual life gain. They have that Mistress of Mixtures, but it's not incredibly easy for them to maximize value. They find a Faceless.
Okay. So they do have...
They can cast a million spells this turn, because
yes.
Emperor has gotten off two ticks. So they may have... kind of stabilize here if they even really want to. They could copy the Mistress of Mixtures.
Mm-hmm.
Just go at it.
Copy zero mana worth of minions with your Faceless. I mean, obviously, in this case, the combo is not going to win you this game.
Right.
You do not need it. So you piecing apart your combo in the best way that you can will be a better use of your resources. So, I mean, Faceless on the Faceless Shambler would give them access to another taunt, or here, like you were saying, it looks like they're going to be going for the added four health.
I really like this. And I would not, if I were in their shoes, I would not object to just Shadow Flaming the first one. Shadow Flaming one of those.
Mm-hmm.
It gets them out of range of any possible combination of burn. They're at 10 life, and it feels like they have a pretty dominant board position.
Yes.
And if New Jersey were to have Lava Burst, Jade Lightning, they could win the game next turn. If Maryland does not gain some life this turn. You've seen one Lava Burst, mm-hmm. and there's just been some cards kind of sitting in your opponent's hand. It is a worst-case scenario, but it feels like they have the ability to
It feels like
try.
It might be worth playing
right.
around, even the lowest-case scenario, because you're so likely to win from
right.
this point
That's
on.
In a lot of cases, I feel like players can get into situations where they try and play around everything and thus give themselves a worse chance to win.
Mm-hmm.
But when you are in an incredibly advantaged position and you can afford to use your resources playing around possible combinations that could kill you,
it
can often be worth it.
Because, I mean, three of the four cards in Maryland's hand are for dealing with large boards, and TCNJ knows from this point on there's pretty much no way that they can win the game, so they're going to go ahead and concede University of Maryland taking game number one.
Yeah, and I really think that game, interestingly, did kind of follow from that Doomsayer on turn two. Obviously, Doomsayer is a powerful card to mm-hmm. stall the early aggression, but the specific sequence that New Jersey chose to take in the early turns left them unequipped to deal with Doomsayer when they could have been in a position where they could have spent resources to kill it, and maybe that might have made the difference.
Yeah, potentially they could have had 2-3-3 Tunnel Trogs as well as a small-time Buccaneer on the board after having dealt with the Doomsayer, and then they actually drew patches on the following turn, meaning that if they'd played the Buccaneer, they wouldn't have drawn patches, which would have given them an extra card as well. So definitely could have played out very differently there because Maryland never actually drew Reno Jackson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
All right, so Maryland going up 1-0 early on. Need to get a win with the Shaman and the Rogue. Still the Rogue. We saw suffering a little bit yesterday from some poor draws. However you may look at it, definitely didn't perform at its best. And then TCNJ needing to find a win still with that aggro Shaman, a Mage, and a Warrior.
Speaking of decks that have struggled, though, Shaman, interestingly, has not performed terribly well in the matches we've seen so far. We obviously just saw it lose there to Reno Warlock, which is generally a decent matchup, but not necessarily an amazing one. This is this could be a very volatile matchup as we get into game number two with Rogue versus Shaman.
Yeah, the aggro Shaman can certainly blow out the Rogue very early on, but now with the Pirate Package in the Rogue, it has the ability to stand up against the early game much more easily. And then cards like Questing Adventurer and Edwin Van Cleef are more likely to stay on the board against the aggro Shaman because they don't run Hex.
Yeah, and the fact that the Rogue deck now, as you mentioned, has the Pirate Package, does mean they can compete with the early turns. And in particular, Maryland's going first, and they have their small-time Buccaneer, and because they're playing Rogue, they just have a hero power that activates their small-time Buccaneer. And that basically strands the opposing small-time Buccaneer in their hand. We do see the Spirit Claws picked up. But yeah, New Jersey could play their small-time Buccaneer, which would just lead their opponents to hero power and potentially just crash in and trade, or even just eviscerate and keep the full health on their own. So New Jersey could choose to Spirit Claws here and just kill the 1-1, or play their Buccaneer. The problem, one of the things about Buccaneer is it comes attached with patches, which is fantastic with Flame Tongue Totem. So they could just choose to Spirit Claws now, and then next turn, Buccaneer and potentially even coin out Flame Tongue using the patches to kill the opposing Small Time. So there's a lot of options. People think about, Aggro Shaman, and it kind of plays itself in the minds of some players.
It really doesn't.
But there are so many little sequencing things and even positioning things that can make a huge difference in terms of your likelihood to win games.
Yeah, I mean, if you small time coin Spirit Claws here, the patches and the Spirit Claws clear off the small time Buccaneer. But then on the following turn, Maryland Hero Powers run patches in along with the dagger, and there goes the small time Buccaneer. That does leave TCNJ with, you know, just Totem Golem on 2, Totem Golem on 3 looking like the plan for them now.
Yeah, and I definitely like the way that New Jersey chose to navigate this. They, because they had the claws, could just go ahead and take out the opposing Buccaneer pretty much immediately. And you know, now they do potentially have less value from that Flame Tongue Totem, but they're reducing the opposing board presence as fast as possible. And like you said, the Totem Golem here, pretty tough to deal with, especially followed up by another Totem Golem next turn.
The Jade Lightning pickup actually makes this sequence kind of interesting going into two turns from now, because Jade Lightning against Azure Drake and Tomb Pillager is, you know, such a fantastic clean clear. But if TCNJ chooses to play the Totem Golem on the following turn, which is, you know, from the hand just what it looks like, then they will actually not have access to the Jade Lightning on 4.
And this is a kind of a sad turn for Maryland. Looks like dagger to the face, re-dagger.
You can coin, conceal Edwin.
Well, they picked up a counterfeit coin, which could mean next turn they can coin, eviscerate, and play Edwin, which can remove one of these Totem Golems, and make yourself a 6-6, which is pretty strong.
Yeah, now TCNJ picks up the Flame Wreath Faceless, which is even more tempting to play on turn 4, but again, they have the choice now of this turn playing Totem Golem, and then on 4 being left with the Flame Tongue Totem, which is still fantastic, gives them a very strong board, but delays that Flame Wreath Faceless one turn more.
Yeah, Flame Wreath Faceless isn't necessarily super exciting in this matchup. You're really afraid of getting it sapped. And obviously the body, if it does stick in play, is about as big as it gets. But the tempo loss, specifically from that card against Sap, is so brutal that you often don't want to sculpt your turns around getting to play that quickly.
Yeah, I can just set you back so far that you end up losing the game as a result. So it looks like Maryland's going to go with exactly what you said. The coin eviscerate into Edwin gives them a 6-6 Edwin Van Cleef, which challenges the board very well. TCNJ can clear it off with the Flame Tongue as well as a hit from their Spirit Claws, but they're going to be taking quite a bit of damage from it.
And there's another Jade Lightning. That's one of the better cards in Shaman, generally speaking, against Rogue, because both Azure Drake and Tomb Pillager line up perfectly against the 4 damage. As you mentioned, New Jersey does have the ability to clear off this Edwin thanks to the Flame Tongue, and I would suspect that's the line of play they're going to take. While the 6 damage is a lot, Rogue isn't a deck that just continuously pressures you with burn. Yeah. They've already used an Eviscerate as well, so their ability to just kind of end the game out of nowhere is much more limited than, say, a deck like Shaman that has so many different burn spells.
Also, you've seen Counterfeit Coin, and no Tomb Pillagers up until this point, meaning that if there was a Gadgetzon in hand, likely there's not a lot of cards that you can combine with it up until this point. Preparation, obviously, is one of them, and is probably the best card to use with it, but Maryland still looking for that gadget to expand their hand even further.
Yeah, this is a matchup that isn't necessarily about the big gadget turns, but can get to the point, if your opponent does play defensively like New Jersey is, that you need that big rush. And that's also kind of one of the problems for the Rogue in this matchup, is they do have the cards that kind of don't necessarily do that much on their own, like Conceal, which has been in their hands for so long. We do see the quick
snap
discover
pick on
there
the steady shot.
As Thrall turns into Rexxar.
The only time we get to see Rexxar
yeah, exactly.
is when it's Thrall or Morgul.
Another counterfeit coin.
I guess Garrosh or Magni.
Oh, and there is that Auctioneer. So that's the, you know, Mean Streets of Gadgets Inn. That guy's from the real Mean Streets of Gadgets Inn.
The OG Mean Streets yeah. of Gadgets Inn.
Like, back in my day,
we didn't even have Jade Golems or Kazakus.
Yeah, we just killed people with Leroy from 20 health. Oh, wait, we still do
we
that.
We still do. We just don't use Shadow Step anymore.
Yeah, it's just a little bit different.
Semantics.
A little different, but now it is another Flame Tongue picked up for New Jersey. And I would not be surprised if they just pushed damage here, or I mean, they could trade push in five with the Finley, and then just trade off the other Flame Tongue.
Yeah, I mean, it's at one.
Well, they, rather
you anyway.
Only push it through with the Finley that way. Yeah, because there is a dagger waiting to just kill the Flame Tongue. So, and then they could, if they wanted to, just play the Flame with Faceless, which does put Meriling in kind of a bind if they do go into the Gadget Zan turn, because they really need to have a sap, or else they're just taking so much damage.
Yeah, we're assuming that. I mean, pretty much every Miracle Rogue deck has two copies of Sap in it. Occasionally, you see one cut for second counterfeit coin.
On Ladder these days, I've actually seen a lot of gadget decks only play a single copy of Sap, because Sap is fairly weak against most of the minions in Shaman. It's only really good here against exactly Flame Wreath Faceless. And then also, it is fairly weak against Pirate Warrior. So if those are the most popular decks you're looking to face, Sap isn't that good in those instances.
Yeah, in a Reno Jackson meta against a lot of Reno Warlocks, it's much stronger. Even in the Rogue Mirror, it's not going to do you too much good.
Mm-hmm. And now Maryland trying to figure out, okay, they drew a minion off of their conceal here. Oh, they found Sap, and look at the celebration.
They are excited
that
about
is
that.
Exactly what they wanted. Reaching up for the high five. Oh, it's a preparation into the Sap. Oh, they even have backstab too. They can backstab down the Flame Tongue totem. All of a sudden, this board just completely swung around, and Maryland has a healthy 21 life. And are going into their next turn with Auctioneer in play, though they do have no spells currently in hand.
I mean, this is what Miracle Rogues have been doing since the dawn of time. They do pretty much nothing up until turn 6 or 7, and then they just go off. And from then on, they draw their entire deck, and a lot of the times, there's just nothing you can do to stop them.
Well, here, though, Maryland really does need to start finding spells. They find a backstab.
Question is, do you questing before you play the backstab? You know,
what are they looking for is kind of the question. And they could even double questing and try and really go nuts. And I think that's what they're debating. Do we play the second one? I think they're going to give themselves the opening to draw Fan of Knives, which they would not be able to play. Well, they find Cold Blood.
Let's see what else they get. Blood Mage
no
spell knows.
More spells. This is one of the problems sometimes with Miracle Rogues. Miracle Chains, when they are playing a little heavier minion version with the double questing and such. Ooh, they are just going to the face. They see that they have, you know, Leroy in hand, and New Jersey can only on board at least kill one of their two big threats.
Yeah, but New Jersey has 11 damage represented here with the steady shot. At most 15 with the Jade Lightning, so they're not quite able to take down Maryland, but it's getting very close.
Yeah, and Maryland definitely recognizing that the initiative was theirs, that they needed to push damage. And over time, this game is going to potentially go to New Jersey because they have more burn, they have steady shot. And it is up to Maryland to push the damage. And that Tomb Pillager lives, though, and that is Leroy Jenkins, who will come down for exactly lethal damage.
Yeah, they've got 11 exactly with the Leroy from hand. You don't even need a Cold Blood or an Eviscerate this time. Nothing fancy, just simple Leroy. Not like the old days of Miracle Rogue with Leroy, Shadow Step, Leroy, Shadow Step,
well,
Leroy.
A big part of that is the early minions that can get in those chunks of damage.
Yeah.
And we did see the Shaman attacking into several minions early on and getting a little bit of chip damage here and there. Then obviously the big hit of 8 from that Auctioneer. Those all add up.
Yeah, and then choosing to actually hit face with the Auctioneer there, Maryland did have the option of trading into the Flame Wraith Faceless if they felt like they could possibly die on the following turn, which, with the right combination of cards, it was very close.
Right.
It was very close. So they decided that their best chance of winning was going to be go face. It's unlikely that they have exactly what they need to kill us, and you know, they essentially played to win, which I really like there. I think a lot of the time you see players playing a little bit too safe. And in this case, Maryland played to their outs and they got there.
Yeah, they didn't want, you know, chat to be like, missed 8 damage. And they didn't
traded with the 4-7-7. Yeah, exactly. So hopefully chat will be kind. All right, but now Maryland up 2-0, just needing to close out one game with their own Shaman deck, and TCNJ really struggling with theirs, still needing to find wins with the Mage, the Shaman, and the Warrior.
Yeah, as you mentioned earlier, and a number of times yesterday,
yeah.
Shaman hasn't had the kind of dominant performance that many might expect that it would have in a non-ban format. It's clearly a very, very powerful class, but one thing we have been seeing is that these have all really been tended to be the aggressive versions of Jade. We haven't really seen much in the way of mid-range Jade, which has actually, in a lot of cases, for many top players, kind of supplanted the aggro versions in terms of preference.
Yeah, I personally, if I have to ladder with Shaman, which a lot of the times now it just feels like if you're not laddering with Shaman, then you're kind of doing something wrong. I tend to prefer the more mid-range Jade variant. I think Hex is very, very strong in this current meta in, you know, a lot of matchups. And if you can just really ramp your Jades, go towards Aya, even Jade Chieftain, it's very nice.
I told you, I was on the Oasis Snapjaw side.
Yeah.
Just popped up again.
We actually see Earthshock in Maryland's hand. That's a really interesting inclusion.
That is an unusual choice in Maryland's list. But we do see the Buccaneer, though. That entire hand from Maryland could be aggro, could be mid-range.
Mm-hmm.
Because all those cards are played in both.
Yeah.
Well, except for the Earthshock, that's not really played in either.
but if you're playing against
Earthshock,
a Twilight Drake.
Yeah, it is an interesting choice. And I'm curious, maybe that is to have additional utility against Frothing Berserker, which can be kind of tough. It's also obviously, as you mentioned, good against the Twilight Drakes or Faceless Shambler out of Reno Mage, and crucially Doomsayer, which we saw really swing the tempo in Maryland's favor in game one when they played it with their Warlock.
Yeah, I mean, it's in a lot of cases just one mana remove taunt. Also can be really good for the Shaman, because that's a lot of times exactly what just keeps Reno decks alive. Is the ability to taunt up several minions. So it's an interesting tech choice. I never thought we'd actually have to bring up Earthshock in a panel on the side, because some people didn't know.
It's
been a very long time since we've actually seen Earthshock as a meta card.
This is an awkward hand for New Jersey here. They have three weapons. They did just open up with the Spirit Claws. Really hoping for Spell Power here. That is not Spell Power. That is Searing Totem. And now we see a head in hands from Jersey here, trying to figure out, okay, what are we going to do about this totem goal? Because not only do they not have the ability to kill it right now, looking at their hand, they don't have anything that kills it in, like, three turns.
If they hit with the Spirit Claws this turn, assume that the Searing Totem will hit as well, and then hit with the Jade Claws on the following turn. Technically, that would clear off the totem goal, but that is expending so many resources and, you know, potentially 9 of your own health into a 2-drop minion.
Right. And, that hurts. I mean, I think this is the right play. It seems brutal. And I mean, it is brutal.
Yeah.
But it seems like, what are you doing? You're attacking a 3-4 for 1. But how are they going to clear this goal?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the answers is exactly what you said. Another is maybe now they, you know, can find something that does the 2 additional limb. Maybe they roll Spell Power next turn, and they can kill it with the Spirit Claws. So in particular, Maryland doesn't have access to the ability to Hero Power, so they couldn't get a Healing Totem or a Stoneclaw Totem to take it out. And yeah, we are not going to see the possibility of that Jade Claws teaming up with the Searing Totem as Patches takes it down.
Okay,
we do
small-time Buccaneer. With the Jade Claws, Patches can actually take out that Totem Golem, then you leave up your opponent's small-time Buccaneer, however.
Right.
That's always, I mean, it's never something that you want to do.
Well, you do have the option now, because you have the Buccaneer, who itself is a 3-2, you could just play your Buccaneer, send the Patches and your weapon into the opposing small-time Buccaneer, and you at least have a 3-2 when your opponent is a 3-3.
In that case, you could actually hero power first, try to get the spell damage, and then from there decide what to do with your small-time buccaneer. But yeah, absolutely.
Because the Totem Golem is obviously the scariest looking card right now, but the Buccaneer is pretty scary too, and that's a pretty good roll.
It's not bad.
That's a pretty good result from the hero power, giving them at least the ability to mitigate the next attack from Totem Golem.
Yeah, I think the only totem there that you really wouldn't want to see would be the healing totem. Even searing at that point is okay.
It's
does
bad.
1 point of damage. So yeah, Stoneclaw definitely not bad. Maryland picks up Feral Spirits, makes their next turn very awkward, but.
Yeah. I mean, they'd obviously love to play the Flaming Faceless this turn, but they also just want to be able to maximize the impact of what they're doing right now. And speaking of Flaming Faceless, New Jersey picks up their own, and they could play it into an opposing board that would have only five attack, assuming they attack into and trade with one of these wolves. Then Maryland, you know, would need to do something to deal with that 7/7. So it's got to be at least fairly attractive.
Yeah. The Aggro Shaman Mirror is actually quite interesting in that it is, for the first several turns, Battle of the Board, essentially. And then the first person to really secure that board state is able to decide when the tide of the game changes. When am I able to just start going face instead of fighting for that board position? And here, that's really what we're seeing right now. So TCNJ likely will attack in with the Buccaneer, play their own Flame Wreathed, and then Maryland will have to respond, killing the Flame Wreathed and trying to build their own board back up. And it's a very reactionary game.
And this is an interesting attack. They choose to soften up the Spirit Wolf. This leaves it vulnerable to the Jade Claws next turn if Maryland were to choose to just go face, which is fairly crucial because if they simply left that up, they might be able to not get value out of that Jade Claws attack, and their 7/7 would just be stranded. So I like this, though Maryland recognizes that this is what this is telegraphing, and they just send the damage to the face, so that setup attack on that on that wolf cost them a lot of life.
Yeah, now TCNJ has to.
That is quite nearly lethal damage.
That is 7.
They have 7 points of burn.
Very close. Potentially they could forego damage this turn and instead. Well, they could Flame Wreath Faceless and Lightning Bolt their opponent's Flame Wreathed.
That is, that's definitely got to be a pretty attractive option. You set up a huge threat and remove your opponent's huge threat. It is always a little bit disheartening to give up what is nearly lethal, but you're playing something that can attack for nearly lethal, or in fact, exactly lethal, well past lethal because of the flame tongue.
Another possible play, you could have attempted to roll for the 25% Wrath of Air Totem and send Lightning Bolt
mana
to the face this turn.
That's true.
Instead of playing the Flame Wreath Faceless, which seems a little risky.
But yeah, New Jersey here, they are going to struggle to get this this Flame Wreath Faceless off the board. They drew a Flame Tongue, but they're overloaded, so they can't quite send in enough damage. Oh, a Taunt Totem is pretty nice. It at least looks nice, but there is the
Earthshock
in hand.
Who knew? Earthshock's good.
Well, they don't. Oh, there. That's actually lethal damage thanks to the Jade Claw. So, Earthshock taking away Taunt. And Maryland, you see, they are very excited to push through 9 damage to the face, and that is enough to close out the first match. Are those like fake bills being thrown at them from off camera?
It was definitely
real money.
Some
I don't know.
Form of money. Now would be the time for them to start throwing again. Fortunately, we will get the chance to ask them exactly the denomination of the bills that they are throwing in celebration. So University of Maryland 3-0 over TCNJ. Really a dominating performance from them.
Yeah, everything really felt like it went their way. And, I mean, we saw New Jersey playing Shaman in every game.
Mm-hmm.
And this wasn't an instance of, they drew patches in every game and their draws were terrible or anything. They played Shaman against 3 different decks, and the Shaman deck just didn't have what it took in those games to really get the wins.
Yeah, Aggro Shaman, which is pretty much the only Shaman we've been seeing over the last couple of days, it's a very strong deck. Don't get me wrong. It's very strong on ladder, and when piloted well, can certainly win in even the most disadvantaged of matchups, but it's definitely been sort of falling very short over the last couple of days. And, who knows, we may continue to see the downfall of the Shaman in this tournament over the rest of today. But we do have a short highlight to show you from that last match very shortly. But until then, really just want to highlight the fact that these are college players. Obviously, they are college students first and foremost, then they are Hearthstone players second. And we are going to see, you know, yesterday we saw Dude7597, who is obviously an HCT veteran. So there are college Hearthstone players who are professional players, who are the highest caliber of players. But a lot of the time, college comes first, Hearthstone comes second. So it's interesting to see how those two lives can sort of fit together and how that will really affect the gameplay.
I mean, when I was in college, my gaming came first. I was not a responsible student necessarily.
Okay, well,
I did totally fine. I graduated.
To be fair, I did miss like 2.5 weeks of my last term of college to come out here and cast Hearthstone. So maybe we're not the best examples of how to get the most out of your college career. But to be fair, these guys, I'm hoping, are at least spending some time studying in between matches. It's only one match per week, guys.
True.
It's not that much of a time commitment, but you want to be ready. So you want to have your dollar bills lined up to throw when you win the game. But to get the dollar bills, you know, maybe you have a part-time job.
Whoa.
Who knows?
I think we do have that highlight to take a look at. So, this is that final game where the New Jersey team has their own Flaming Face. Let's go ahead and just roll the clip. And we have the attack into the Spirit Claws into the Wolf here. Spirit Claws into the Spirit Wolf. They're both spirit things.
Very spirited.
And this was New Jersey trying to set up the ability to attack into the Wolf with their Jade Claws the next turn. But unfortunately for them, Maryland read exactly that plan and just pushed the damage to the face and really punished them for that, what I think was a heads-up play, but it just didn't work out for them.
Yeah, TCNJ had been having to take quite a bit of damage from weapon attacks proactively into the Totem Golem on turn two, even just to bump it down to 3 health, and then the Wolf, which we saw right there. So that had added up, and then Aggro Shaman, like I said, at some point needs to decide when to stop trading with the board and just go face and end the game very quickly, and I think from that point it was, what, 2 turns?
It was all over.
It
did not take very long.
Yeah.
This game's going to turn around very fast.
Yeah, absolutely. And we will have an interview with our winning team, University of Maryland, very shortly. Really very spirited guys, played very well. And their Aggro Shaman actually, I think, was the only one we've seen so far over 2 days that got a win on its first try.
It was also the one we've seen with Earthshock, which is an interesting inclusion. And I'm definitely interested in asking them what the sort of motivation behind that was. And also, they managed to get that win with Rogue, which is another class that we've seen kind of struggle throughout the event so far.
Yeah, their Rogue start was pretty good. I mean, they had Small-Time Buccaneer on one. It's always something you want to see with the Rogue. But had they not drawn Gadgets in Auctioneer when they did, it could have been actually very easily a loss for them, because they drew it kind of at the exact right time and then were able to just combine it with Preparation, Conceal, Counterfeit Coin, the Sap, and the Backstab that they drew exactly on time. So the stars kind of aligned in that case for the Rogue deck, but definitely very well played by them. And, going forward, it is 6 more weeks of tournament play. So they're not out of the woods yet. And certainly TCNJ is not out of this tournament either. Teams with a record of 5-2 or better actually will make it to the regional playoffs. All right, we have a short interview prepared with University of Maryland, our team winner from match number one. Can you guys hear us?
Yeah. Hey, what's up?
Hey, congratulations. Really great job, guys.
Thank you.
All right, so first question we have to ask, was it real money you were throwing in the air, or are those counterfeit? What are we talking? Can we get like a close-up of what you were throwing?
It was real money.
It was real money, okay. Some dollar bills. I won't ask you how you got them.
Who's actually helping like make it rain on you from off camera there? Because you guys were intent on the game.
I was just
throwing them up yourself.
I was wondering, you had like
just making it.
Well, I mean, it certainly left an impression. I mean, it's got to feel fantastic representing the University of Maryland in this tournament. Do you have friends rooting you on? You guys are college athletes now. This is awesome.
We made a post about it in our fraternity group meet, and I made a personal post, and there were definitely a lot of people tuning in, so it was definitely cool to me.
Feels good, yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, absolutely, like I said, fantastic play. Is there really one deck that you guys brought that you think is your weak link, or how do you feel about your lineup overall?
I think, so I think we were talking about it, Pirate Warrior seemed pretty weak against what's currently lined up, especially since he brought Mage and Reno Lock. So we weren't sure what, like, with his self-ban, we weren't sure which one we were supposed to ban ourselves. But then we decided, like, overall, it's just less consistent than the other decks that we have.
I want to ask about your Shaman deck. You included an Earthshock, which coincidentally ended up getting you right through that taunt to get lethal damage in the game. What was the rationale behind that inclusion? Because that's not a standard card we see.
For Earthshock, usually when I was climbing like Legend ladder with it, sometimes if it's like control matchups, you could get through a taunt that's unexpected for the opponent, so they wouldn't like normally play around it, so that's why I included it. And also it's like, it's good at removing minions if you have Spell Power Totem up too, so I guess.
Not bad against Doomsayer either.
Yeah. The Doomsayer that was a huge win for you guys in game number one, that Doomsayer on two taking out TCNJ's Tunnel Trog and Totem Golem really set the pace for, I would say, the entire match at that point.
Absolutely.
So really incredibly well done. Congratulations, guys, and best of luck moving on in this tournament.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, that was University of Maryland, the winners in our first match of the day, a 3-0 victory over TCNJ. So really fantastic stuff from them. And let's go ahead and take a look at our schedule for the rest of the day. So, of course, you can see there Maryland over TCNJ, 3-0. Coming up next, we're sticking with the East region. It's going to be University of Massachusetts taking on Sherbrooke, our first Canadian team representing Quebec. And then moving on to the North region, it will be Carleton versus Nipissing. So it is going to be a fantastic couple of matches we have coming up. Don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be right back with University of Massachusetts versus Sherbrooke after this.